Good afternoon all. It's a very nice experience to join you during OSAPCON 2021 after a tough year taken by Corona. And we have learned many, many new things in Zoom meetings and virtual meetings and all. It's all good for our health. Anyway, today I'm talking about management of distal radial fractures by percutaneous spinning. So far, all the surgeons, they manage the distal radial fractures the way which they feel like, but there is no standardized protocol for any of these fractures. I am giving a standardized formula for all management of most of the 5-pin fixations, which I have been practicing from 1993, almost more than 25 years. And I have already presented this and published this article in Trauma 2017, where I have shown 490 cases with 496 distal radial fractures with very good results. Management of distal radial fractures is a controversial topic. So when you go into the literature, it fails to classify the fractures logically, and the literature view shows the outcome is poor, whatever be the method, in approximately 30% of cases. So let us start from the beginning, from the basics, and apply surgical anatomy. So before going into it, we must all remember that most of the science has been made by the industry. So we will keep away from the industry and learn the basics. So distal radial fracture is the foundation of the wrist joint. And this is a corticocancellous junction, which is very prone for fracture in osteoporotic or even other ways. And the shape is like a conical shape. And whenever you put a wire in the distal fragment, because of the conical shape, they tend to converge at the fracture site. And at the fracture site, it is not three wires, it is just a big wire. So, and more, if the wire is unstable, reduction is unstable, you can see the pins are all getting infected or loosened out. So you all must be knowing what is the classification, like radial column, intermediate column, and ulnar column concept of distal radial fractures. So all these columns are made for column-specific plating, locking plates. But nobody uses it for percutaneous spinning. So percutaneous spinning, you put it wherever you like. The plate is designed for a particular column only. So remember about the deforming forces after a fracture. The brachioradialis is inserted to the distal part, and the only tendon in the distal controlling the distal part of the radius after the fracture. And all other tendon bypass the fracture and have a concertina effect to collapse the unstable fractures. The proximal fragment, we tend to forget about this part. The proximal fragment is under the control of biceps, supinator, pronator teres, and quadratus. And generally, whenever you have a distal radial fracture by fall on outstretched hand, the most stable part is the distal bone. This is not the distal bone which displaces. All the soft tissue damage happens to the proximal fragment. So in fact, it is not the distal fragment which is moved out, the distal fragment which is moved to the other side. When we take an x-ray, we see in a different issue. So distal radial fracture, we all know, when it is malunited with more than 2 mm of articular displacement, or when it is shortened more than 5 mm, or dorsal angulation more than 20 degrees, we can expect a suboptimal result. So we tend to remain within the safe margin of the position of reduction. So we have so many management options, so close reduction and cast. You can have below elbow cast, you can have above elbow cast. But this literature wise, it always says that an above elbow cast gives the best result for distal radial fractures. And you have pin and plaster, percutaneous pin fixations, external fixations, and open reduction and internal fixation like fancy LCPs. So the paradox of the distal radial fracture is sometimes you get a perfect reduction, perfect position, but you will have completely stiff hand. Whereas here you can see this completely displaced fracture, but you have very good function. So that can happen in most of these cases, in some cases. So look at this one. Is it a fault of pins or the pinner's fault? There is no standardization. They put pin wherever they feel like. This is another case, not even reduced. Pins are not holding the fracture. Pin is practically remaining outside. And here you can see all the wires have widened the joint, and you can get the reduction and shortening. That is the end result because of poor pinning, poor fixation. So the concept of pinning is you can pin it wherever you like. Because of that, there are various types of pinnings, and most studies attribute very bad results because of pinning due to radial shortening, stiffness, and CRPS. ORIF with the fancy LCPs, only for very rare water button fractures and in affordable classes. It gives more money to the surgeon and the hospital. And you know, it contributes to the growth of economy of the country. You must be knowing the story of a cycle, bike cycle. The cyclist never improve the economy of the country unless you buy a big car. So you must remember the latest solution is not the best always. Talk to your patients, rely upon the science as much as possible, exercise your best judgment and listen to your conscience. We do have a lot of poor people with distal radial fractures who cannot afford the mainstream treatments and still need a good quality function at their wrist for working even in old age. So what is 5-pin fixation? It's a fragment specific, lockable, stable fixation with external fixator properties, most minimally invasive, functional, least expensive, and suitable for most unstable fractures. So in fact, this is my second case. Then you must be thinking, who is my first case? My first case is my dad. He had a distal radial fracture. I did my first 5-pin fixation on him. He had a Smith fracture. It was misdiagnosed as a Collins fracture. And some surgeons planned to do ORIF on that. So I took him back to my clinic and I did 5-pin fixation. He had excellent. He's about 94 years now. He's doing excellent, very well. So this is my second case. This patient from Jamshedpur, bilateral distal radial fracture, was subway surgery. He flew from there. He is a brother of one of my close friend surgeon. I managed like this. And this is the result. And the result is after 5 years. So the reduction of any fracture is a deformity correction through the fracture site. So we must understand the deformity to do the deformity correction. So whenever you reduce a fracture, you must understand what are you going to do there. So if you don't know that, then you won't get the perfect result. So our rationale for new reduction is, what are the deformities of a Collins fracture? Dorsal displacement, dorsal tilt, lateral displacement, lateral tilt, supination and impact. This you have to write for your exams. But think about that one. So to reduce, it's actually just a supination impact of the distal fragment around the distal radial ulna joint. Patient falls on the hand, his body rotates, and the distal fragment gets supinated and impacted. When you take an X-ray, it just projected as the above complex deformity. It's actually an illusion. Based on the deformity principle, you can never get that sort of deformity of dorsal displacement, dorsal tilt, lateral displacement, lateral tilt in one fracture. You can never get it. So it's only an illusion. But you have to write it for your exams to get a pass. So to reduce, you just have to disimpact it, distract it, and pronate it back into position. Check the relationship of the radial and ulnar styloid and confirm it by CR. Dive punch fragment, if any, may be elevated by percutaneous scare wear as a joystick. So now you can see I am just distracting and reducing. So that is the only manipulation you need. There's nobody giving traction, nobody pulling it. Yes. Now, as it was reduced by distraction and pronation, our first step is to save what you get, like block the shortening and block the supination of the distal fragment. So you know, remember brachioradialis, this is the only tendon attached to distal fragment. It is in a supinated position, brachioradialis is a pronator. In the pronated position, it is a supinator. So the first wire is the distal ulno-radial wire 1.8 mm. From the distal ulna, through the inferior radioulna joint subarticular to the radius. Maintain the length of the radius and prevent supination. Take care when there is a radial styloid fragment. When there is a radial styloid fragment there, this wire can push it off. So in that case, you have to put the radial styloid wire first. Now the second wire is 45 degrees oblique in both AP and lateral planes. So proximal to the radial, it comes to the proximal to the radial fracture onto the radial cortex on the ulnar side. And that fixes the ulnar cord. That AP view and that is the lateral view. Now the third wire is the listeous tubercle wire. It goes to the volar cortex of the proximal radius. Maybe sometimes it may be with the far distal fracture. You don't have to get the distal this thing there. You can just go through the fracture like a Kapanji wire. That this one mainly prevent the dorsal tilt. But you have to be careful. Try to save the EPL. You can impale the EPL if you go ulnar side of the listeous tubercle. Always remain radial side of the listeous tubercle. Now go on to the fourth wire. Fourth wire is the ulnar corner wire on the radius, which stabilizes the intermediate column from the dorsal ulnar corner to the distal radius to the lateral cortex of the proximal radius. So these four wires control the distal fragment very well, but not good for the proximal one. You remember, see this? All the wires are crossing at the fracture site. So the proximal fragment is under control of the supinator, pronator, and the biceps. So all these three wires will not be able to control the proximal fragment rotations. So that need the very important wire, that is a proximal ulno-radial wire. From the ulna to the radius, proximate to the fracture site. This wire is very, very crucial. It controls the proximal fragment from deforming forces of pronators, supinator, and biceps. So that is the fifth wire, an ulno-radial pin on an intact ulna. If there's a fracture on the ulna, you stabilize that first and then put it. So this converts the ulna into an excellent neutralizing external fixator without crossing the joint. Sometimes you may need additional wires depending on the comminution. If so, all the wires are bent 90 degrees and kept outside. In osteoporotic and badly comminuted fractures, when you think wires are not holding very well, you can connect them together by Umex. Occasionally, some are buried under the skin if there is skin tethering. If you feel they are not holding well, just connect them together by Umex or any sort of extension fixator. You see this? That is a fracture reduced in an 82-year-old lady. Bone was very weak and the stability was good. It was rotating there. So I bent our KVS like that way and connected them together by that bent KVA. So you can see the grandma moving her hand and fingers in the first day post-operative. So the post-operative care is just give a Diana spring in the functional portion of the wrist. They are encouraged to remove the spring on and off very frequently, at least 6 times a day, and mobilize the wrist, fingers, elbow, and shoulder within their tolerable limits, except in forearm movements. Discharge on second day and are called bi-weekly for pin care. So this is a spring which I am giving, and that is how they remove the spring and move it. So the same patient before reduction, after reduction, 5-pin fixation. This is immediately after fixations. So this is the 8-year follow-up function. So post-op care is ulno-radial wires are removed in 6 weeks and forearm x-rays are started. The rest of the pins are removed in 8 weeks after taking an x-ray. Encourage to resume mild domestic activities and especially dishwashing in warm water. Post-operative care further reviews every 2 weeks for physio for another 6 weeks. Most recover fully in 2 to 3 months. Another x-ray was taken at 3 months to confirm healing and to rule out any bony collapse. Further reviews at 6 months and 1 year. We always look for pain, wire loosening, wire infection, nerve injuries, tendon impalement, CRPS, wrist deformity, instability, function, and radiological findings. So I'll show you some cases. See this, very badly fractured. This is after reduction and fixation. This is the long-term result. That is the X-ray after 3 years. So this is another case. You can see this intra-articular fracture and all columns are fractured. And you can see the function. Another one, which is a very far distal fracture. It's fracturing at that level. Here you can see that fracture should go to subchondral area and stabilize it. That is the result after, this is a 3 year result. An old lady with a fracture in the ulna, you can see I have stabilized the distal one by additional wire. One more wire on the ulnar head and additional pin there. And this is after healing. You can see the grandma with very good function. So this one, again, far distal fracture. You cannot think about a plate holding that fragment. And that is the end result. Here again, you can see such a small fragment displaced. And that is the result. So this man, see, dorsal lip fracture. Think about any plating in this case. And with that. So this is again, these are all far, far distal fractures. That is the result. So this, just think about this small fragment there. You can even go to reduce it and put it there subarticular. And get a result like this. So this is a long-term sort of similar patient. So CRPS and RSD or reflex sympathetic dystrophy, we are not found in our series. Maybe due to the excellent stability of five-pin fixation. CRPS is an abnormal neurohumeral response to pain. Pain in distal radial fracture is always due to instability. When there's a pain, it produces spasm. That spasm is mainly meant for immobilizing it a little more. But unfortunately, this spasm produces local ischemia and that again goes into pain. And that enters into a vicious cycle, resulting in a fully established CRPS. In this moment, I would like to experiment and share my experience of a CRPS where a distal radius was fixed by external fixator. She came to me after 5 days of external fixation. I discussed with my chief told nothing can be done, probably we'll do a VS block. Then I told, since there's nothing can be done, why not I put an olive wire and connect it to the external fixator. So he being an anesthetic himself also, I just put an olive wire, and the next day there is no swelling and she got all the functions back. So that opened my mind, like, now when you give adequate stability, the body doesn't have to create the spasm. So that is one reason for my proximal radio ulnar pin and more stability. So 5-pin works well even in osteoporotic. The principle is unity is strength. All together it locks the fracture. We are only restricting the forearm movements for 4 weeks. And the potential complications we must always remember, wire loosening. If you find, you can always block it with a X-fix, wire infection, injury to the superficial radial nerve, very, very difficult to injure the radial artery. Tendon impalement is very, very common. You can impale the EPL or ECU. And remember, cavar injury to the surgeon. You can even fix in a compound fracture. See that case, you can see the compound wound there. And this can be healed very well by 5-pin fixation. The same, you can see the ulnar head is reduced and fixed with the 5-pin fixations. So that's all. Thank you. Thank you for your kind attention.
Keep going.
I have a similar 5-pin fixation for calcaneal fractures. So I initially started doing calcaneal fractures open and fixations. I used to do the, expose it and elevate it, put a percutaneous cavae after seeing it. After finishing about 5-6 cases, I found I'm doing the same job again and again and again. So then I started doing my CT and started fixing them by percutaneous methods. So it is otherwise known as the Lovers fracture or Don Juan fracture, the most frequently fractured tarsal bone, about 60%. tarsal bones account 2% of all adult fractures. It's mainly because high energy collision. I'll always look for other injuries in 10% of cases, fracture of the spine, hip or other calcaneal fracture is a possibility. Often damage the subtalar joint. Subtalar stiffness make it difficult to walk on even ground and slopes. So we must know the surgical anatomy of calcaneum very well for better understanding and better management. So just think about a brick. When it breaks into pieces, can anyone reconstruct it? Unfortunately, we surgeons, our job is to reconstruct that broken brick back to the position. So you remember about the wound healing problems after ORI. Take care of the vascular supply. It is very difficult. The vascular, if it gets infected, you know, calcaneum will eat your brain like anything. And biomechanics of the calcaneum, the hind foot, the tarsal bones form an articulated ring of bones. Talus joins calcaneus to cuboid to navicular to talus. So it's a circle, it's called a kinematic chain, which is an engineering marvel. When one link moves, the other links are also forced to move. That is known as kinematic coupling. That is the principle of Ponseti method. Functions of the foot is, one, to accommodate the terrain. That means whenever you walk in different terrain, your foot will take that terrain, shape of that terrain. It's a very good shock absorber, a rigid lever for effective heel off, and absorb transverse plane rotation of the tibia. When you stand straight and rotate to one side or other side, it rotates. Your subtalar joint moves and you can easily rotate. And in brisk walking, 2 to 3 times of body weight at the heel strike happens at the heel. A system of pressure chambers are there under the heel, a fibrocartilaginous fatty tissue, which acts as a shock absorber, stabilizer of the sole. So this is your axial view. I'm sorry for this image is not very clear. This is a calcaneal tibial axis. This is a calcaneal axis. Usually, they are parallel and very close. So you take that X-ray in this. You can see the X-ray here. This is a tibia. This is a calcaneum. The calcaneum is a little bit lateral to the tibial axis. So the mechanism of injury is the talus is driven into the calcaneus and crushes it into powder. And that poor fellow goes back into the position, leaving the calcaneum unattended. So this is what happened. After the impaction, the talus goes back to the ankle and stays there. The poor calcaneum is completely remains unattended and collapses. Now, what are the aims of getting a reduction? Think about the normal ankles, Bowler's ankle, Gissain ankle, and you have a neutral ankle there, and thalamic portion. And you can have these two more lines, which is called the parallel lines, or the diaphyseal line of the calcaneum. So all these things are there for these calcaneal locking plates. You can put these locking plates. There are so many different designs available. But think about in a completely crushed powdered calcaneum, do any of these screws will have a hold? It will have a hold only on the plate and it just stays there. In the powder, there's no hold for anything. And look at this calcaneal nail. So you can design anything for your industry. And my technique is I just look into this, take a CT scan, study the fragment very well and elevate it and fix it in that position. This is a 30-year-old manual laborer, fall from a height, had this fracture, took the AP view and lateral view, axial view, and that is a CT scan. I will find out where exactly the fragment has depressed and where are the fracture lines. And you can see one fracture here and depressed it. Now I have to distract it backwards and elevate it back into the position. The middle fragment or subtalar talus always remains in the posterior. Now you can see that I put the cave at 3 mm hole, then 2.5 mm wire. It reaches at the depressed fragment and you can see it is going up. I just hammer it, bring it back into position. Once it comes to the position there, I lock it by another wire. I'll hold it, keep on pressing. The next wire goes and you know the talus is the guy who created all the problems. So let it be his responsibility to maintain the calcium well. So I put that wire, and the second wire, which supports this scaffolding, support this one, just under the subarticular joint, the third wire, and the fifth wire. So outside you see only this. The patient will have a dorsal slab for about 6 to 8 weeks, and that is the result. You can see all the wires are going well, and the talar body is a strong bone. So these pins fixed onto the talus will spread the calcaneum to the level which you want. That is the long-term result, and it's completely healed, and that is how the X-rays and this is another case. You can see how it has elevated by two wires, pushed it and got into the position. See, look at this fracture. It is completely in powder. That is how we elevate it and get the reduction there, and get the oblique, axial view also. So here you can see that fracture line, and this is depressed downwards. I put a K-wire. That K-wire is being traction backwards. You can hold it and pull it back and push this fragment in. The depressed fragment goes in and it's being fixed to the talus. You can see the oblique X-ray, which shows the subtalar joint very well. That is how it is reduced everywhere. And this is axial view. So post-op care, an anterior POP slab in equine for 6 weeks. And last 2 weeks, encourage the ankle movement after removing the slab. All the caveats for 8 weeks. They walk on high heel afterwards, remove the caveat after 8 weeks, and then walk on high heel, soft footwear, 3 pieces stuck on the heels. Remove one piece in every 10 days and tendo-Achilles X-rays. That is a long-term follow-up, bilateral calcaneal fractures. You can even squat and heels up, walking well. This is a bilateral calcaneal fractures. So this is how it was elevated. You can see because since it's a bilateral one, I have given a ring fixator spanning it, and he can walk on that ring fixators. Thank you.
Stop here. I think we have done it in half an hour. Let's end this meeting and